Good evening, church. Welcome Avalon Church and welcome First Missionary Church. And we have a wonderful opportunity tonight to participate in the Good Friday service together. And that's what we're going to do. Tonight you can expect to participate in some moments of silence. We will take communion together. We will listen to music together. We will hear the words of our Lord together. And at the end of the night, we're going to invite you to shut the lights off and just sit. Tonight is an opportunity for us to step into the last few days and moments of our Lord Jesus Christ's time here on earth. And we know that Sunday is coming, and we know that we get to celebrate in a few days. But right now, church, I want to invite us into this posture of lament, this posture of putting ourselves in the story, inviting those emotions, and grieving the death of our Savior. And as we begin tonight, we're going to say this prayer. It'll be on the screen for you. So let's say this together as we begin. Lord Jesus Christ, you set aside your divinity, allowed yourself to be betrayed, beaten, and broken, and bore the cross for our sake. Be present with us as we remember the pain of your passion, the suffering of your sacrifice, and the price of redemption. Help us to honor your life and your death with our faithfulness and love. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only Son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon the cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed, I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything. No, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer. Should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom.
On the first day of the festival of unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus and asked, "Where do you want us to make preparations for you to eat the Passover?" He replied, "Go into the city to a certain man and tell him, 'The teacher says, my appointed time is near. I am going to celebrate the Passover with my disciples at your house.'" So the disciples did as Jesus had directed them and prepared the Passover. When evening came, Jesus was reclining at the table with the 12. And while they were eating, he said, "Truly, I tell you, one of you will betray me." They were very sad and began to say to one another, "Surely you don't mean me, Lord." Jesus replied, "The one who has dipped his hand into the bowl with me will betray me. The Son of Man will go just as it is written about him. But woe to that man who betrays the Son of Man. It would be better for him if he had not been born." Then Judas, the one who would betray him, said, "Surely you don't mean me, Rabbi." Jesus answered, "You have said so." While they were eating, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body." Then he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink from this fruit of the vine from now on until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." When they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Church, we invite you to, in just a moment, hit pause and grab something to eat. Grab some crackers, grab some bread, whatever you can find. And we invite you to grab some juice as we take communion together. Go ahead and hit pause. Tonight, we are going to participate in communion together, as the disciples did that very night. While they were eating, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body." Go ahead and take and eat. Let's do that together as one. Then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. Take and drink." Let's take together.
Precious Father, we give you praise and thanks for this holy communion, the body and blood of your beloved Son. The body is broken, God's love to make us new. Lord, make us new. Abba, Father, we bless your name and take part in this holy communion. Make us all to love like your Son. The body is broken, God's love poured open to make us new. Lord, make us new. The
Then Jesus said to them, "You will fall away because of me this night, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered.' But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee." Peter answered him, "Though they all fall away because of you, I will never fall away." Jesus said to him, "Truly, I tell you, this very night, before the rooster crows, you will deny me 3 times. Peter said to him, "Even if I must die with you, I will not deny you." And all the disciples said the same. Then Jesus went to them, a place called Gethsemane, and he said to the disciples, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." And taking with him Peter and the 2 sons of Zebedee, he began to be sorrowful and troubled. And then he said to them, "My soul is very sorrowful, even to death. Remain here and watch with me." And going a little further, he fell on his face and he prayed, saying, "My Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will." And he came to the disciples and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, "So could you not watch with me for 1 hour? Watch and pray, that you may not enter into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak." Again, for the 2nd time, he went away and he prayed, "My Father, if this cannot pass unless I drink it, your will be done." And again he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy. So leaving them again, he went away and he prayed for the 3rd time, saying the same words again. And then he came to the disciples and said to them, "Sleep and take your rest later on. See, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand." While he was still speaking, Judas came, one of the 12, and with him a great crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, The one I kiss is the man. Sees him. And he came to Jesus at once and said, "Greetings, Rabbi." And he kissed him. Jesus said to him, "Friend, do what you came to do." Then they came up and they laid hands on Jesus and seized him. And behold, one of those who were with Jesus stretched out his hand and drew his sword and struck the servant of the high priest and cut off his ear. Then Jesus said to him, "Put your sword back into its place, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Do you think that I cannot appeal to my Father, and he will at once send me more than 12 legions of angels? But how then should the scriptures be fulfilled that it must be so?" At that hour, Jesus said to the crowds, "Have you come out as against a robber with swords and clubs to capture me? Day after day, I sat in the temple teaching, and you did not seize me. But all this had taken place that the scriptures of the prophets might be fulfilled." And then all the disciples left him and fled.
Ooh. Then those who had seized Jesus led him to Caiaphas, the high priest, where the scribes and the elders had gathered. And Peter was following him at a distance, as far as the courtyard of the high priest. And going inside, he sat with the guards to see the end. Now the chief priests and the whole council were seeking false testimony against Jesus, that they might put him to death. But they found none, though many false witnesses came forward. At least two came forward and said, "This man said, 'I am able to destroy the temple of God and to rebuild it in 3 days.'" The high priest stood up and said, "Have you no answer to make? What is it that these men testify against you?" But Jesus remained silent. And the high priest said to him, "I adjure you by the living God, tell us if you are the Christ, the Son of God." Jesus said to him, "You have said so. But I tell you, from now on you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming on the clouds of heaven." Then the high priest tore his robes and said, "He has uttered blasphemy. What further witnesses do we need? You have now heard his blasphemy. What is your judgment?" They answered, "He deserves death." Then they spit in his face and struck him. Some slapped him, saying, "Prophesy to us, you Christ. Who is it that struck you?" Now Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard, and a servant girl came up to him and said, "You also were with Jesus the Galilean." But he denied it before them all, saying, "I do not know what you mean." And when he went out to the entrance, another servant girl saw him, and she said to the bystanders, "This man was with Jesus of Nazareth." And again he denied it with an oath, "I do not know the man." After a little while, the bystanders came up and said to Peter, "Certainly you too are one of them, for your accent betrays you." Then he began to invoke a curse on himself and to swear, "I do not know the man." Immediately the rooster crowed, and Peter remembered the saying of Jesus, "Before the rooster crows, you will deny me 3 times." And he went out and wept bitterly. When morning came, all the chief priests and the elders of the people took counsel against Jesus to put him to death. They bound him and led him away and delivered him over to Pilate the governor. Now Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus said, "You have said so." But when he was accused by the chief priests and the elders, he gave no answer. Then Pilate said to him, "Do you not hear how many things they testify against you?" But he gave him no answer, not even to a single charge, so that the governor was greatly amazed. Now at the feast, the governor was accustomed to release for the crowd any one prisoner whom they wanted. And they had then a notorious prisoner called Barabbas. So when they had gathered, Pilate said to them, "Whom do you want me to release for you, Barabbas or Jesus, who is called Christ?" For he knew that it was out of envy that they had delivered him up. Besides, while he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent word to him, "Have nothing to do with that righteous man, for I have suffered much because of him today in a dream." Now the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and destroy Jesus. The governor again said to them, "Which of the two do you want me to release for you?" And they said, "Barabbas." Pilate said to them, "Then what shall I do with Jesus, who is called Christ?" They all said, "Let him be crucified." And he said, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more, "Let him be crucified." So when Pilate saw that he was gaining nothing, but rather that a riot was beginning, he took water and washed his hands before the crowd, saying, "I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourselves." And all the people answered, "His blood be on us and on our children." Then he released for them Barabbas, and having scourged Jesus, delivered him to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the governor's headquarters. They gathered the whole battalion before him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, and twisting together a crown of thorns, they put it on his head and put a reed in his right hand. And kneeling before him, they mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews!" They spit on him and took the reed and struck him on the head. And when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the robe and put his own clothes on him and led him away to crucify him.
As they went out, they found a man of Cyrene, Simon by name. They compelled this man to carry his cross, and when they came to a place called Golgotha, which means place of a skull, they offered him wine to drink mixed with gall, but when he tasted it, he would not drink it. And when they had crucified him, they divided his garments among them by casting lots. Then they sat down and kept watch over him there. And over his head, they put the charge against him, which read, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Then two robbers were crucified with him, one on the right and one on the left. And those who passed by derided him, wagging their heads and saying, "You who would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross." So also the chief priests with the scribes and elders mocked him, saying, "He saved others. He cannot save himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross, and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God deliver him now if he desires him, for he said, 'I am the Son of God.'" And the robbers who were crucified with him also reviled him in the same way. Now from the sixth hour, there was darkness over all the land until the ninth hour. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani," that is, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And some of the bystanders, hearing it, said, "This man is calling Elijah." And one of them at once ran and took a sponge, filled it with sour wine, and put it on a reed and gave it to him to drink. But the others said, "Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to save him." And Jesus cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. And behold, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and the earth shook, and the rocks were split. The tombs also were opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. And coming out of the tombs after his resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many. When the centurion and those who were keeping watch over Jesus saw the earthquake and what took place, they were filled with awe and said, "Truly, this was the Son of God."
it shall I borrow to thank thee, dearest friend, for this thy dying sorrow, thy pity without end. Oh, make me thine forever, and should I fainting be, Lord, let me never, never outlive my love to thee. Should I fainting be, Lord, let me never, never outlive my love to thee.
When it was evening, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who also was a disciple of Jesus. He went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate ordered it to be given to him. And Joseph took the body and wrapped it in a clean linen shroud and laid it in his own new tomb, which he had cut in the rock. And he rolled a great stone to the entrance of the tomb and went away. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were there sitting opposite the tomb. The next day, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered before Pilate and said, "Sir, we remember how that impostor said, 'While he was still alive, after 3 days I will rise.' Therefore, order the tomb to be made secure until the third day, lest his disciples go and steal him away and tell the people, 'He has risen from the dead.' And the last fraud will be worse than the first." Pilate said to them, "You have a guard of soldiers. Go, make it as secure as you can." So they went, and they made the tomb secure by sealing the stone and setting a guard.
At this time, church, we invite you to shut the lights off and to sit in darkness. We invite you to allow the death of our Christ to sit on your hearts, to feel the weight of this loss, and to grieve alongside the disciples as we remember. And as we close today, receive this song as you continue to sit in darkness.